longer piece actually, which was originally called Place as Assemblage. So there's a lot of overlaps here with some of Michael Wood's talk earlier in some ways. So I've been long been interested in the concept of place and the rather ambivalent relationship to it because of how much disagreement there is over what place means and how that concept might be used. But it does have this multi-scalar sense of everything from the planet to the seat you're sitting in can be called place. And in each case, I think you can also call the place an assemblage. But for the most part, I would talk about this as city as assemblage. It's an account of really my attempts to apply assemblage thinking over a period of time. And in many ways, I came to this from the phenomenology of place and indeed attempts to grapple with the idea that understanding place meant grappling with issues of power, and ultimately that led me to assemblage thinking. And this is an attempt to understand what it is that makes cities cohere, or what makes cities tick, and the ways in which assemblage thinking might change the ways we research, we understand, and ultimately that we transform cities. Now I'm going to decorate the talk. I'm not going to read the words off the screen, but rather decorate it with a series of images and maps and diagrams from some of my work. And I'm not going to go into the specific cases, which I think will ultimately, if we get too much detail, prove irrelevant to many of the people in this very multidisciplinary audience. But instead, there's a kind of a very oblique relationship then of the images to the talk. Assemblage thinking is flat in the sense that it doesn't recognise a transcendent order to which the immanent world can be reduced. The flat ontology is one whereby the world is a field of differences from which identities emerge. Assemblage thinking then seeks an understanding of the general within the particular. It resists the hierarchy of identity over difference and of the general over the particular. We abandon the hegemony of scale, the presumption that architecture and urban design, which is my background, can be reduced to geography or planning. Assemblage embodies a renewed attention to the particulars of the city, to the microspatialities and materialities of everyday urban life. While assemblage can be understood as a general theory, it's not a model of the world within which the particulars can be reduced to the general. The particular is not an instance of the general. Rather, what becomes general emerges in part from the interactions of the particulars. Assemblage is a theory of power with its roots in the Foucaultian critique of power, embodied in micro-practices, as distributed in capillary rather than simply held. And while the Foucaultian apparatus of the panopticon is a key source and model for the assemblage, this approach is exploited for its emancipatory potential as well as its critique of discipline. Within large debates about structure and agency, Deleuze and Guattari are firmly on the side of agency, yet there's a good deal of what might be understood as structure within assemblage thinking, where we find a set of resonating twofold concepts, or what I call twofolds. Rhizome tree, smooth, striated, becoming, being, identity, difference. The twofold is not binary, and power is not reduced to hierarchy, to policy, to governance, or the larger scale. It's axiomatic to assemblage thinking that power is distributed and embodied in material spatial arrangements. Assemblage enables us to understand the practices of power within cities in terms of both policy and everyday life, both power over and power to, top down and bottom up. It's an approach that can differentiate between practices of authority, of coercion, of seduction, manipulation, camouflage, resistance. An assemblage approach will understand the city as being produced by flows of desire, the imminent force of attraction between parts of an assemblage. Desires are multiple, intersecting, and often contradictory. The suburb emerges from the desires to have daily access to the city without living in it. The desire for a room with a view produces agglomerations of capital investment, in particular urban morphologies such as tall buildings or topographies such as waterfronts. Such desires for access to jobs, for views, for status, sociality, for profit, and so on, are at once productive of the city and are produced by it. Desire is neither subjective nor objective. It can't be simply located in the view, nor in those who desire it. It is rather a flow or a relation. Assemblage enables us to understand the ways urban land markets work as bundles of desired amenity. Any city or urban location embodies an assemblage of amenities and practices that can only be exchanged as a bundle or as a place. The parts we desire can't be disaggregated from those we might wish to avoid, such as danger and congestion. What we might call neoliberal assemblages operate to meet the market for a purified city in which the negatives have been largely removed. Corporate towers, gated enclaves, shopping malls involve the production of quasi-public assemblages where the disbenefits of public life are removed along with urban intensity. Some parts of cities produce what we might call the urban buzz of an intensive urban learning environment, urbanity as an intensive multiplicity. This notion of urbanity has many synonyms and cousins, such as atmosphere, vitality, character, sense of place. But the generic term we might here use is intensive urbanity or urban intensity. These are experiential phenomena, and while they might be described in phenomenological terms, we will simply be describing the result, the emergent effect. Urban intensity is at once a product of the city, an attraction that is consumed, but also a form of production. One of the key assemblage thinkers in urban theory was Jane Jacobs, whose mid-20th century work involved key breakthroughs in understanding how cities work. She first argued that urban morphology at street and neighbourhood scales are crucial to the creativity and productivity of cities, and later that innovation and import replacement were more crucial than geography or agriculture for metropolitan growth. While Jacobs contributed major insights into how cities work at different scales, she rarely connected these scales, and multi-scalar thinking remains a key challenge. The multi-scalar assemblage of the city has what I have called an urban DNA, conjunction of density, mix, and access, where density is the concentrations of people, practices, and buildings that have the effect of shrinking distances, where mix is the set of co-functioning synergies between people, practices, and places that is at once a social, functional, and formal mix, a mix of mixes. And access is the capacity of infrastructure networks to facilitate flows at every scale between buildings, neighbourhoods, and cities. To understand this nexus means understanding the city as a three-dimensional, multi-scalar morphology. This nexus of density, mix, and access doesn't determine urban outcomes any more than human DNA determines who we are, but without them, it's not a city. A significant prospect for assemblage thinking lies in a better understanding of the relations of informality to formality. Large portions of cities of the global south comprise informal settlements that have emerged outside the control of the state. Our understanding, or largely outside the control of the state, our understanding based on formal cities of the global north is now proven utterly inadequate for engagement with the issue of informal settlements. Rather than seeing them as slums to be erased, we need to understand urban informality as a mode of production, as a means of managing poverty. Over half a century of demolition and replacement strategies have failed and often stimulated more such settlements. Such neighbourhoods are in no way marginal to the economies that have attracted them, and the only realistic future is one of incremental formalisation in situ. We need approaches to urban informality that can understand the formal, informal, twofold, which is another one of those twofolds that has so many resonances with assemblage thinking, and the ways in which the slipperiness, the subtlety, the camouflage, the rhizomic movement work as resources for managing poverty. We need to articulate the many ways informal settlements, while also often slums, are already engaged in processes of becoming formalised in terms of upgraded construction and infrastructure, as well as tenure, urban design codes, and state control. Any process of formalisation by the state needs to understand such formal informal relations rather than simply replacing one with the other. Informality is a mode of urban production with morphogenic processes very different from those of the formal city, where you go from this in 2008 at Site in Buenos Aires to this in 2015 without being involved in the state. It's a very different urban DNA. Informal settlements are not chaotic. Rather, they emerge through informal codes, a morphogenic process, more subtle than the formal city. And indeed, these are codes that often predate the modern city. It's just some analysis of how that occurs. Kind of anticipatory do-it-yourself urban planning. Assemblage thinking also enables an understanding of the city in terms of both actual and possible worlds. Here, the inspiration of my work from Manuel Belander's work is quite apparent. In terms of both actual and possible worlds, this distinction between the virtual and the actual. The city as an assemblage of people, places and practices, at once a set of actual arrangements and the capacities for what the city might become, how it might be transformed. This opens up what Belander calls a space of possibility, a capacity to become transformed, designed and planned in a range of different ways. Urban studies can become much more closely geared to the creative and critical practices of architecture, urban design and the arts, where design research emerges as a field of research conducted through design, where boundaries between research and practice erode as we experiment on the city as a living laboratory. We often think of knowledge as embodied in words and numbers, with images serving a largely illustrative role. The kind of dominance of the sciences and of the arts in universities. Most academic discourses about space, including the so-called spatial term in social theory, have remained contained within a verbal logic. Still read books about space without any representations of space. Lefebvre is the classic case. Indeed, there's a sense in much social theory that a focus on the particularities of urban of spatial form is a kind of fetish, as if spatiality were merely the foam on the surface of deeper economic and social forces. Again, a kind of reductionist attempt, generally represented by numbers. Mapping is a practice of engaging with difference in the city, has a particular role in Elizabeth Howard's thinking. It involves selecting and juxtaposing layers of data from the field of possible data in order to produce new ways of seeing the city that are not visible to the naked eye. Gregory Bateson, one of the guy who invented the concept of the plateau, famously argued that information is a difference which makes a difference, and that differences are the things that get on the map. The differences between cars and public transport, between mixed and monofunctional, between multi-ethnic and monocultural urban districts, all make a difference to how cities work and to how they can be transformed. The task of mapping is not to expose or identify some supposed pre-existing truth, but rather to expose a logic through which the urban assemblage emerges to disclose and unfold possibilities and potentials. The duopoly held for so long by numbers and words is eroded as maps, diagrams and images become potent forms of spatial knowledge. A key test of assemblage thinking, in my view, lies in the usefulness of new ways of thinking about cities that it opens up. And I want to conclude here with an argument for a deterritorialization of urban theory. Intellectual territories are largely established and defended through jargon. The extensive use of neologism, of which a thousand plateaus is prime example, often renders assemblage thinking incomprehensible to its potential audience. The use of an exclusive language plays a key part in insulating different modes of thought from each other and in separating different learning assemblages. Learning the language is the price one pays for admission to the club. The use of a private language then is a micro-practice of power that turns ideas into ideologies and defends them from attack. At the same time, new language can be required for new ways of thinking. A key criterion for the use of jargon is whether it is useful beyond the confines of the theory. For Deleuze and Guattari, philosophy is the invention of concepts as tools for thinking. Assemblage, then, is a conceptual toolkit. We shouldn't be surprised when a new tool is given a new name, and if it turns out to be useful, then that name will find a common usage. Such conceptual tools are adaptable rather than specialised. The task is to render the concepts transparent while preserving a certain indeterminacy of use. While a hammer is of little use for digging a hole, it can be used as a paperweight or as a weapon. Yet Once the point is nailed home, then the tool can disappear along with the jargon. Theory, seems to me, is the means rather than the end of assemblage thinking. Assemblage is not a theory where all the parts fall into line with a strict orthodoxy, but rather a loose set of alliances between different modes of thinking. This theoretical multiplicity is necessary in urban studies because the city is such a multiplicitous phenomenon that requires different modes of thought in order to understand the ways in which it operates. The point is not to assert assemblage thinking as a general theory of cities, but to build alliances between different theories of the city, a deterritorialization of urban theory. Theories are forms of territory where intellectual capital is consolidated and protected, along with the reputations of those who contribute or who sign up. Yet multiplicitous thinking is precisely what is required in order to better understand cities. Assemblage is such a theory of multiplicity, of exploring the spaces between territories as a primary means of producing new ideas. One of my key interests in this regard lies in connecting assemblage thinking to the range of theory that emerges primarily from the sciences, broadly known as complex adaptive systems theory and resilience thinking. Particularly the focus on the multi-scale model of adaptive cycles, expansion, conservation, collapse and reorganisation, referred to in Alemi's earlier talk, that have so much in common with the movements between territorialisation and deterritorialisation that characterise assemblage thinking. This is what I call the complex adaptive assemblage. So in the end, the choice is not between different modes of thought, so much as between the singular and the multiple. What is most needed is not for scholars to sign up to an assemblage approach, but for a deterritorialization of urban studies, for more open and productive interfaces between disciplines and approaches. This is a couple of other images. And if I had time, I wanted to talk briefly about the different projects I've been engaged in as forms, really forms of becoming a project on creative clustering that tries to understand how it is that creative industries migrate to particular parts of cities, where startups become something else, where one thing becomes another, transit-oriented neighbourhoods, where there's a car-dependent city that is becoming low-carbon, where monofunctional suburbs are becoming multifunctional, and indeed the informal settlements project, which seeks to understand informal urbanism as this mode of production where slums are becoming safer, where informal becomes more formal. And that's just where this stuff comes from. The earlier book, Becoming Places, the one came out last year, Urban Design Thinking, and one that is yet to appear, Mapping Urbanities. And that's it from me. Thank you very much.